Manistee City Council work session for Tuesday, March 14th, 7 p.m. is now called to order. Work session items, we've got two items on the work session this evening. The first one will be a discussion on the pilot ordinance and related items. The second will be a discussion on Housing Commission, Century Terrace, and Harborview. At this time, we'll take public comments on work session related items from anyone that wishes to make comment. Are there any comments? Please come forward, state your name, address.
Members of the council, I think you all know me, but my name is Bob Daniels. I live at 59 Smith Street and am a proud native property owner, resident, and taxpayer in the city of Manistee. I'm also the president of the board of directors of the Manistee County Council on Aging, and I'm here to provide any information or try to answer any questions council might have as you're discussing the two items tonight, because they are both of great importance to the Council on Aging. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name's Pete Potterpin. I'm with PK Housing and Management. I'm here to offer any help we can tonight, answer any questions that you folks might have regarding the proposal. And Chris Potterpin is here. He's a numbers guy. He knows everything inside and out on this particular deal. So we're here to help and answer any questions you might have. Thank you.
Thank you.
Evening. My name is Kerry Gavigan. I live at 380 First Street. And I just want to make a comment regarding developers coming in, building housing units and things like that, and getting a cut in the property taxes. I'm just wondering about what about the rest of us that invest in Manistee? You know, I'm not building anything new, but I am restoring things that are old. I started in 1995 across the street. Currently, I have 26 units. Last year alone, I dropped $120,000 into labor and materials. I've done that consistently for 10 years. And the previous 10 years, I worked on them also, not at that same pace, but still, I didn't have the income then. If I could land a 10% in lieu of taxes, that'd save me $10,000 to $12,000 a year. I could use that to put a new roof on, siding, some windows, upgrade the electrical system, probably hire another full-time person. You know, we all have to pay our fair share, and I don't mind doing it. But if these developers come in and they're getting something free, why can't I? And the rest of us that are investing in Manistee. Thank you.
Thank you. Does anyone else wish to speak on any agenda-related items? Discussion on a pilot ordinance and related matters. City Manager.
Yes, as Councilor Regal, I presented council with a recommendation to change our ordinance on pilots from having just has to be equal to 10%, and I believe 35 years, and because one of a developer was requesting something different, and it didn't provide any latitude. And after some discussion, council tabled it and wanted it brought back for this work session to talk about it a little bit later. So that's how we got where we're at. I think it was last Friday I sent council information at the request of the mayor on the pilots that we have in existence now. So that was available for you for your review and consideration. I did reach out on our city manager's listserv and posed the question of communities that had pilots, what they, you know, how, what the levels are and for how long, and I was only able to get three responses, which was surprising. But so we have that information for council if you want to use it. Councilmember Beaton provided some information financial information that she put together, and I asked Ed Bradford to take a look at it and massage it a little bit, and we put it together. That's available for council's review tonight. So it's, where do you want to begin? I guess that's what I need to know. Where do you want to go with the discussion?
I guess I would be interested in hearing the communities that had pilots and what their, if they ever were brought down to 4%.
Right. One was from the village of Brooklyn, and that they have currently have a 40-year pilot at 10%. So that's the only pilot that they have in place right now. The city of Tecumseh, they have, how did I ask that? I asked four questions. Do you specify a minimum pilot? Brooklyn didn't respond to that part of it, but Tecumseh said they had $100,000 minimum. And I asked, do you specify a maximum pilot? And they said, yes, 9 plus 1% admin fee. And then the third question I posed, do you specify a minimum number of years for a pilot? They don't. A maximum number for a pilot of 20, next number of years. And that was Tecumseh. Then the only other one I got was Plainfield Township, which is just north of Grand Rapids. And they didn't specifically reply to each question, but they have a pilot that they just reduced from 12 to 10 of shelter rents. And they extended the pilot for an additional 30 years, and it was part of being able to do some rehab on the property. So that's the only information I was able to get from my peers across the state.
So there's no pilot that you are aware of that goes down to 4% in 50 years, other than what the state says?
The only thing I'm aware of, and I should have mentioned this, that I did get some information from our city attorney about Ludington really recently granted a pilot for their mixed-use housing downtown, and they accepted a two percent pilot plus a municipal service agreement in the neighborhood of around $7,500, $7,800 annually. So that's the closest one.
I think it's 48 years too.
It was
48 years.
That's one thing I didn't bring in my stack of papers.
And that's for their two new developments that they're going to be putting up
the one
downtown.
Right now.
So they'll have 60 units.
I believe Midland just approved one 4%.
Yeah, I don't know. I put it out. This listserv goes to every manager pretty much in the state. That's the only ones I heard of was from those three. So I can't say that there's none out there 4%.
I was curious on the communities like ours, like the size of ours, because Midland doesn't compare to ours. So.
Yeah.
That's why Ludington's pretty interesting when you think about it.
Yeah. What was Ludington's again?
The one that they just approved was a 2% pilot, and then they had a municipal service agreement, which is around $7,500, $7,800 that they pay annually.
Yeah.
And I remember the term of the pilot was over 45. So those are the only ones I know of. When I was in Alpena, we renewed a pilot, so the developer did do some rehab, and I believe that was at 4%. It was part of their request to rehabilitate the old apartment complex. So that's about the extent of my knowledge of what's going on across the state.
You know what's sort of interesting about the Ludington one is they buy or buying property where the fire station is, so that the city can build a new fire station. So to me, there's some similarities between the Olson project and the senior center doing this.
Do you want us to put up that financial information that Councilmember Beaton and Ed worked on?
Absolutely.
I
I think any information people bring to the discussion is going to help people and enhance their understanding of what the process is all about. I know the Grand Rapids Press last Thursday indicated on a 103-year-old building downtown, they're going to, City Council just approved a 2% pilot on that building.
Sure, yeah.
Was that sent to us?
What's that?
Was this sent to us?
No, it was designed for the work session. Councilmember Beaton emailed an analysis to me and said, does this seem reasonable? And so I looked at it. It pretty much mimics what has been already provided to council. It's just in a different format in your memo, so I just sort of went through it. The first line here shows the taxes on the current Olson store, which is the grocery store and a good portion of the parking lot. That taxable value is about $670,000 and generates total taxes in the neighborhood of $40,000. Of that $40,000, the city tax portion is about $12,000, but the DDA does capture some of that. So we get about $4,750 in revenue off of the Olson store. If you were to compare that to the proposed project, the taxes on the new, assuming that the senior center, you know, takes possession of the Olson's grocery store and uses a portion of it for their purposes and leases the other portion to another grocer, the value, and these are values are from the city assessor, it's about $321,000 that would be taxable of that property. And that would generate about $19,500 in taxes, and the city portion of that would be about $2,283. The assessor has estimated the value of the new commercial space that is included as part of the new housing project at about $48,000. That would generate total taxes of about $2,800. And again, the city would get about $338 of that because the DDA does capture that.
I have a quick question.
Sure.
When the assessor did this, she probably didn't, I'm assuming she did not figure in inventory, real property, where they have inventory and office supplies.
There's no personal property. This is just the real estate.
Okay.
I'm sure that office would get a personal property.
They don't have personal property anyhow. So.
Because they probably
okay.
won't have that much. They'll qualify for that exemption more than likely.
Okay.
Ed?
Yes, sir.
The current taxes on the, is that the Olson's complex with Dollar?
No, it's
dollar?
Not. That's just the grocery
just
store.
Just the grocery
right.
store.
Right. That part is going to stay on the tax roll because there's leases on it.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah, this is just to do a comparison between phase one and two and what we have there.
So the total estimated pilot, and I use kind of an average, like I think it was year two or three, based on the numbers that have been provided to us by the developer, would generate a pilot payment of about $7,800. The city gets about $2,350 of that, and the DDA gets nothing because the DDA does not capture pilots. They only capture ad valorem taxes. And then the I also did an estimate of what the old senior center in the downtown would be if it was purchased and placed on the tax roll. And we use an estimate of a $200,000 assessed value, $100,000 taxable value, just a rough estimate. That is not on the tax roll currently, and the assessor has not assessed it, but she thought that was a conservative estimate. That would generate about $5,900 in taxes. Unfortunately, it would generate no revenue for the city because when that DDA was founded, the value of that property was zero, and the DDA captures any growth in that, so all those taxes would go to the DDA. So the total for the new taxes there would be to the city about $4,900, and the last line shows the net. So overall, if you base on all these assumptions, the net in total taxes paid in pilots would be about a $4,000 reduction. The net in city taxes paid would be about a $1,200 deduction, but the actual benefit to the city and DDA would be the city get a very, very minimal positive, and the DDA would lose about $1,500. This analysis does not assume that the property is fully taxable or would be built if it was fully taxable. The developers have told us that it would not be built if it was fully taxable. This is based on the proposal that they have in front of us. And again, this information, not in this format, was provided to council more or less in the memo. I think this estimated old senior center taxes is a new item because it's very likely that that property will go back on tax roll relatively soon once it's vacated. So I just wanted to present this to council, more for discussion than anything, but to also get the facts out there as to what we think the best estimate of the tax impact for the community would be.
And you still think that this is beneficial to the community? And I stated that last time after doing this.
My personal opinion is it's beneficial for a variety of reasons, as I said before. My professional opinion is that if this project isn't built on this property, that it's going to sit in its current state for quite some time. I don't think there's another likely use to go in there. The discussion has been maybe a strip mall goes in, and we know how businesses move in and out of that. And plus, there's already a lot of vacant retail space and things that we can do. So, with the proximity of the Dial-A-Ride, with the fact that we would get a new grocery store that's walkable to the community, that's providing a need for housing that has been identified, it spruces up that corner, it generates utility revenues. And one thing I forgot to mention at council the other day is I think it certainly opens up opportunities for grant funding to reconstruct Memorial Drive when you lump that project as well as the Edgewater project in there. I think that gives some potential for some Category F funding. It's not a guarantee, but certainly something we would look at. So I think overall this is a big positive for the community, in my opinion.
I would echo Ed's statements. My biggest concern is that I don't know how long, if this project doesn't go, how long that property might remain vacant. And it's a large building. And what I'm seeing as I read the newspapers and stay up on the world events and the national events is MC Sporting Goods closed up, and it's a big retailer. And just today, Gander Mountain is closing a number of their stores. Macy's closed a bunch of stores, JCPenney's. I don't know what we could get in there in terms of a retail that could occupy a footprint of that size. And my concern would be that it would remain vacant, blighted, and an eyesore on a major corridor. And the statistics are out there on the need for affordable senior housing. When I talk affordable, it's through the whole spectrum. And this, to me, is one of the fits. The current senior center is just bursting at their seams. I've been down there numerous times, and I just wonder how they get them all in there. This provides a space that is more than adequate for their needs, allows a little bit of room for growth. What I like about it, the way it's packaged, is that the senior center, or the Council on Aging, can own that property. And the lease for the grocery store, as I understand it, is going to pay off the debt service on their loan. So they wouldn't have to expend any millage monies to have a new build. And so they can keep all that money for programming. And as Ed said, we have a grocery store, we don't have a grocery store in town. They're talking, there's a distinct possibility of getting a pharmacy there as part of that new retail, which we don't have in town. So there's a number of benefits, plus it meets a housing need that we have in the community. I think it's a great fit for our community. I don't know what else would go there. Could something materialize? Yeah, anything could materialize, but I've not heard of anyone nosing around looking for a space of that size.
I've been doing a lot of extra reading. I'm sure everybody else has too, because I know our level of interest in this. There's a website connected to Washington website, connected to Washington, which has a think tank kind of an element to it on housing, and the statistics are pretty frightening when you think about it. For every 100 people that need low-income housing in the U.S. right now, there's only 29 available units. So that's a huge thing to try to, we think we have an overabundance of them here, but when you think about it, this is across the U.S. That's a national statistic. So it's something to, and it is because, I'm sorry, but it's my generation. that's aging, and we're living longer, and we're going to need the housing. So you can blame the boomers.
You know, when I look at housing, and I look at some related statistics, such as median household income, and as I looked on the Census Bureau site today with their estimates for 2015, Manistee as a city has declined to about $36,300 in median household income from about $41,000 in 2011. We keep building things. We did Reese Park Village. We've got Cherry Hills Apartments. We've got these other apartments. We've got our housing commission. We keep drawing low-income people, and I'm not speaking against people that have lower incomes than the norm, but I'm saying we keep drawing more and more population in that regard. Since 2010, we've lost about 500 people in population in the city. A number of people moved from the city to the townships. We talked a little bit about that, the perception, I would say actually reality, we're at the highest millage we can assess in the city for property tax. Without going to the voters and overriding that level right now. It can be a disadvantage to do that. I just got my assessment in the mail, update, and mine's going up 5%. You know what, if I go up 3% or 5% a year over the next 45 years, my property taxes are gonna double. What's this property gonna do for us? What's it going to do to contribute to the revenue stream that we need to support our services and move forward and fix our streets and do other things in the community? What does it do along the same line that the individual taxpayer in the community does? Or like Kerry does with his rental apartments. He's paying the full non-homestead tax rate on his apartments. It's all his money that's invested. You know, it's not tax credit money. It's not special low-interest long-term loans. It's his resources that he's contributing and investing in a community that he lives in. You know, and I look at those things and talk to some of these people, $7,800 a year in lieu of taxes. Wow. For an $8 million facility. And yes, I did ask for information about what other pilots were active or what pilots that we've done. I don't have all the information I'd like to have. I'd like to know the true tax value of those properties. Just because I get asked questions, they say, okay, you know, how long has Reese Park Village been there? Well, you know, it's been there for a number of years. It's under a 35-year pilot. What would the taxes be on that if it wasn't under a pilot? I mean, it's a legitimate question. We have our other one, it used to be Chalet West over here, and I think that's the most recent pilot from 2011. They're paying, what, a $2,500 service, municipal service fee per year? There's no escalator on that?
There is.
Every year? I mean, then I read articles like in the Sunday newspaper. Now there's a concern that we have a company that's going out loaning these ventures money, and then foreclosing, or getting a deed transfer in lieu of foreclosure, and shutting down the low-income housing that they were obligated for 15, 16 years before the term ends. and I see that as a senator on the West Coast opposing some federal legislation, and we've also got a state representative that's looking at that, and it's referred to as, quote, a loophole. You know, it's a significant loophole when in the state we've got 550 low-income units that now are market rate, 2 and 3 times the bargain rate, because someone used the loophole to foreclose on the property after, mind you, they collected 10 years of tax credits. They didn't foreclose on them until the 10 years was up, and they got all the tax credit out of it, which wasn't refundable. You know, I look at some of those things and I wonder where we're going. 2% in Grand Rapids, 2% in Ludington. The worst we have on the books right now is a 10%. That's really, in my opinion, quite a concession. Versus what the estimate of $242,000 a year is what the taxes would be if that was just a commercially built project on that site. That's a significant difference. What are we going to do to generate revenue? We have been minus revenue on property tax for each of the last 7 years. When's it going to go up and start contributing to a fund where we can have $600,000 or $700,000 a year for street maintenance? You know, or we can look at paying for our MERS retirement costs, and we can look at maybe expanding some services and such in the city, because everybody that's in the city that's paying taxes now expects to maintain those services or see improvement. And I have those concerns, and I hope they're considered legitimate concerns.
We'll just quickly address that. The budget that we'll present to council, at this time it looks like we're going to show a growth in our taxes, about 1.5%, which is not a lot, but it's significant because we've been going the other way for a number of years. And also, it's going to show fully funding our obligation to MERS, even with the accelerated numbers they gave us. So we are addressing those things as we speak.
What this chart doesn't show, too, is what we had estimated for water and sewer usage for the apartments, which I think you told us it was about $35,000-$36,000.
That's what the public works director estimated.
So we, you know, in order, that only helps our water and sewer fund, which we need that extra revenue.
Right, I mean, that number offsets a significant portion of the lost revenue we had when the hospital and some of those other buildings switched over to the tribal sewer or the township sewer. So that helped.
And do you know if that's going to be assumed by the tenant or by the developer?
What's that?
The water sewer.
I'm not sure how they're planning on doing it. They do them both ways. I don't know. I think he said at the meeting, they said that the tenants would be paying the utilities. But
he said, from what I heard, they were paying the electrical. The tenants would be paying electrical. The water and sewer, they probably would have absorbed.
Either way, they either... They structure different ways. It depends on what they're
doing. When you absorb, and I'm trying to learn this, so when you absorb it, do you then take it off as an expense before you figure your 4% or whatever the payment of the taxes might be?
Yes.
Okay. So actually you pay it, but then you deduct it, so the taxpayer would actually end up paying it.
Yeah, so how the pilot's calculated, any common utilities that the apartment building pays for the residents would be subtracted from the gross rents collected. So if he collected $100,000 in rents and he had $30,000 in utilities, $70,000 would be the base number that you figure the pilot on.
Okay, so my mind is telling me, well, in reality, then that means I'm paying it. The taxpayer's paying it.
Not exactly, Councilmember Zelensky, because it's only at 12%. So that $30,000 deduction in this example is only generate $1,200 or reduce the pilot by $1,200. There's still $35,000 of revenue going.
Okay,
to
I get you.
Right.
I hear
you.
Is the water and sewer on that $36,000? Is that on phase one and phase two?
Just phase one. Just on the first building. None of this addresses phase
two. Wait, okay. Phase one is the way they put it is phase one is the Olson's project, and then phase two is the actual building?
That number was based only on the residential build.
Okay.
It has nothing to do with the grocery or the senior center.
Okay.
Which I suspect that's not going to change a whole lot. It may go up a little bit with the senior center preparing meals and stuff, but it should be similar to what they're doing now, I would think, close.
Is there anyone that doesn't pay water and sewer?
Is there anyone that...
Anyone that does not pay water and sewer to the city?
What do you mean by anyone?
Any housing development, does Roots Park pay water and sewer?
Yeah, they all pay, well, if they're cities.
I mean, I'm trying to figure out what that got to do. I mean, I know the housing commission pays water and sewer.
What?
I mean, everybody pays the utility. I mean, that's not like, you know, bonus revenue. I pay water and sewer.
Right, well, it's only from the standpoint that we have excess capacity, and if we can serve more customers, it spreads the cost overall, and customer base and reduces that. We don't have to add any infrastructure to, well, I shouldn't say that, there may be a water main loop that we might have.
But I think more importantly, we were just pointing out that that's a new revenue that we don't have now. So if it's built, you know, we'll realize that. And if it isn't, we won't. That's the only point that we're putting out, is that there is a benefit if the building is constructed, because there's not that building isn't there. We will realize about $36,000 in our water and sewer fund. If it's not built, we won't.
Okay.
That's just, we're trying to demonstrate that there's other revenue streams for the city outside of just taxes, pilots. So we're just trying to account for all potential new revenues.
I know, and when we recently completed an agreement with Fido Township, that Fido Township doesn't pay ad valorem taxes to the city of Manistee, that we required them to pay $400,000 buy-in to the system, since they had not contributed to the construction of our water and sewer system, in addition to paying a bulk rate that they're going to go for. You know, and I guess that's my point. Anytime we have an agreement with someone that doesn't pay ad valorem taxes outside the city to use the city utility, water or sewer, we either have a payment in lieu of tax on top of the rate, or we charge them a multiple of the rate or connection fee above and beyond what would normally be paid for their contribution to the infrastructure that we have.
And this would pay a connection fee, the standard connection fee for city properties?
Well, when I look at these ad valorem taxes and I see, you know, what we're projecting here, and I look at this, the part that the city gets, the part the DDA gets, also missing from that is school taxes, county taxes, state taxes, and I know we keep asking the state when we're going to improve the funding of revenue sharing and such as that. When we do these pilots, and when other communities do the pilots, they're taking the tax revenue from all the other entities that are around us, including the school system, as well as the city. So I think that's, is that true?
Well, the $7,800 that you see right here, mm-hmm. I distribute via a formula. The state sends me a form, and it splits it up amongst all those taxing jurisdictions. So they get some portion of this. So
okay.
Of the $7,800, there's about $6,500 that the city is not getting, and that gets split up amongst the other taxing jurisdictions.
MISHDA projected for Ludington that when they start construction on these two apartment buildings, they're going to have 160 contractors in their area at various times. So they're expecting that in the downtown area, and the restaurants are expecting more traffic as a result. And they're looking for housing too. I mean, their hotels and everything are going to be looking for housing of these contractors, which could happen here too on one of our projects, maybe not 160, but maybe 80. And you know, they're going to have, a lot of them are not going to want to travel home if they're traveling long distances to our city, because you won't be able to hire everybody locally. There'll be a lot of them coming into this area and seeing our city. So that's a plus you can't really quantify to put a number on what kind of revenue it's going to bring in, or in the long term, hey, Manistee looks like a great place, I think I want to move here or start a business here. But that's one of the benefits that doing development and pushing forward on economic development brings. It's hard to measure, but it does come with it. It doesn't, it's a very good positive to have.
41 units, correct?
42.
42. All right, let me do my math again then. What's an average bill or usage of water for an average person? Isn't it, we figured 6,000 gallons a month?
For like a family of four. These units will probably.
I understand that, but.
I didn't see Jeff's numbers, he just provided them. Maybe he assumed 2,000 gallons a month, let's say.
Okay.
Typical six.
Typical six. I did it on 41, I thought it was 41 apartments, but it's 42, so the number's gonna be off a little bit. Each unit is gonna generate in that $35,000, $853 a year, which averages out about $71 a month for water and sewer. My bill at home is about $70 a month, and I got five people living in that house.
I don't have the.
And I'm just.
Control it to be what it was.
I'm not arguing, I'm just telling, I'm just okay. Pointing out facts. what my calculator says.
Right.
I'm saying they're gonna be paying, so when we say that everybody pays a water bill, they are gonna be paying a bigger water bill than I pay. Just be on the fair, put on the fair plate. You're right, everybody pays a water bill, but they will be paying what I pay for five people, but there'll be one to two people living.
Well, so it is gonna be up there. The same rate we pay.
How do you rate? How do you say?
They're estimating what the water use is going to be.
I don't believe that. That's not the way it was explained to me, that they are going to pay a $36,000.
Oh, no, it's estimated as to, yeah, the estimated number of units, the volume of water they're going to use, what our current rates are. There's not a guarantee that they're going to use that.
They're going to pay.
See, that's not what was proposed to be told to me, and there's a big change. Because it should be around, if that's the case, we're looking at probably $14,000.
Councilmember Kutzmiller, I can tell you that I can provide Mr. McCullough and the engineer's estimates as to what those units are going to do and how that was calculated. And I guess you can make a judgment as to whether or not that's reasonable. But that's the estimate they came up with.
Yeah, I found the email that Jeff sent. And he had the engineers estimate the usage, and what they estimated was 880 gallons a day for the 42 units, or 8,800, excuse me, gallons a day for 42 units. So because there's some commercial space in there, Jeff added another 200 gallons a day for a round number of 9,000 a day for the building. And that would generate annually $250 for fire suppression, $34,000 for consumption, $1,500 for a ready to serve, and then where he came up with $35,750. And then additionally, which we didn't, I don't know if we reported out to council, but they would upfront pay a system development charge of $31,200, which is like a membership fee to our infrastructure. So it's a hookup fee. So the engineers were, for that building, estimating about 9,000 gallons a day total. And that's how they came up with those numbers.
For the entire complex?
For the entire residential building.
For phase two?
The housing.
Phase two. That's how I got to think about it.
How does trash enter? Do I pay trash on my water and sewer bill, and then I pay on my taxes also?
it's different for residential and some commercial buildings. The vast majority of the city residents pay a two or a millage. That's one part of the charge, and then they pay an annual or a monthly fee on their bill. And the two combined revenue sources are the primary sources of revenue for the refuse fund and cover trash pickup and other expenses.
Commercials, same.
Some way. Commercial buildings pay the tax, but they don't get a monthly bill. They contract directly with Republic Services to have a dumpster, depending on their needs. There's some housing complexes that do that.
Do we know how this would work?
I don't. I suspect that they're not going to want 10 tidy totes out in front of their buildings, so they'll probably put a dumpster.
We'll probably have one dumpster in place.
Typically, that's what we have, is one four-yard dumpster or whatever comes and picks it up once, twice a week, so.
And that again is something you would pay and then deduct it from the gross, right?
Yes, yeah, that, what's it, you know, maybe $100 a week, or if that, $80 a week, I think.
While you're standing there, a couple other questions.
Okay.
Is my understanding at the last meeting that a person could have a caretaker living there?
Yes.
Could a person living there, grandchildren be there?
They could not be residents, no. They could obviously visit, but they couldn't be residents there.
Disabled people can reside there, be under 55 and still reside there, right?
No, everybody has to be over 55.
Even if they're disabled?
Yes, sir.
Do you accept vouchers?
Yes.
Okay, so if a person had zero income and they had a voucher, they could still live there?
I think we have minimum income requirements, so I mean, if you have zero income, even though you got a voucher to pay your rent, you gotta show the means to be able to pay your other bills. How are you gonna buy food? How are you gonna pay for your electric and things like that? So we have a calculation that, whereby everybody has to show the means that they have the ability to pay their rent.
I kind of went on the Mr. website, it's kind of, you know, it's kind of confusing. Unless you work it every day, if you work it every day, it's confusing. So I was trying to sort those things out, but it appears that if someone was working through DHS and had some way of paying their electric and heat bill, but had zero income, they could still live there.
Yeah, I mean, excuse me, we have guarantors. It could be a family member that would guarantee that they would pay any ongoing expenses that the resident might have. So they're effectively signing the lease with the resident, saying that we will make sure that not only the rent's paid, but all the utilities are paying their ongoing expenses.
Okay, do you know if you do redeterminations on a yearly basis?
Yes, we have we do income certification on an annual basis.
Okay, so if today my income is $20,000 and I move in, and then my 457 kicks in and I have to start taking money out, and I get over that $20,000, which reading the rules, I have to tell you that I'm now getting more money.
Correct.
Yeah. Or I'm committing fraud. Do I have to move?
Right. There's a built-in regs that I think is up to 140%.
No, this would be, if it's 100% affordable, there's no maximum.
Okay, so as long as you qualify on the way in, once you're there for a year, you've qualified for that first year, then there's no maximum after that. It used to be in the old days, if you could make up to 140% above the median income, but that's gone.
Can you help me understand that? What is a redetermination for?
Well, it's a tax credit regulation, federal reg, that we have to recertify income every year to make sure everybody's, you know, we don't very often run into this problem where people are over income, unless we had two people and they were both working. It doesn't happen very often in elderly housing, but if one person was working and somebody else got a job, they may be over the income, so they would not, you know, be eligible to live there at that point forward. But with elderly, I mean, the biggest thing you have, basically, most elderly have their pension and Social Security, and that's essentially it. They may have some funds in the bank, and that's already figured in as part of the income. That's how you figure that. You take whatever funds you have in the bank, say if somebody had $100,000 in the bank, you impute an interest rate on that of 2%, say. So annual income on that bank account would be $2,000, so that gets added into your Social Security and your pension income. So you'd have another $2,000 in total income when they go through the income certification.
So I'm confused. So is there a max, is there a limit that you can make, or there is not?
To qualify to move into the apartment, there is the...
For the recertification.
The recertification is no. So once you're in and you're qualified, you can remain there.
Even if you made like $100,000 a year?
Right.
Okay. And is there, what if your income drops below 20? Is there,
There's no minimum, but everybody has to pay rent there. It's if we get past the voucher thing. We have rents going from $200 to $500. But if their income goes down to the point where they can't afford to pay the $200 or $500 a month, we have policies to whereby residents, you have to have enough income, so they only pay 30%. In elderly properties, we go up to 40% of their income because elderly don't have as many family expenses as most family properties do. Most families have way more expenses than.
So is that rent and that rent amount determined on a sliding scale based on their income? They may come in, maybe they come in with $10,000 worth of income. You decide what the rent is. Their income goes up $5,000. Does it, or not the rent? If their income goes up $5,000, does the rent then go up?
We have we have three categories here for rent. We have the 60% of the median income, and that rent is $500. We have the 40% of median income. I believe that rent is $300, and 30% of median income, the rent is $200. So if they qualify, if they're at or below 30% of median income, their rent's going to be $200. But if they get a pay increase or they're making more money and it goes up to 40% or less, we'd have to move them. These apartments are classified individually too, so we'd have to move them from a 30% unit into a 40% unit and change the rent amount that they're paying upon their annual recertification.
So you'd have to physically move them out?
Sometimes we can reallocate the unit if we have someplace else. You know, we can change this unit from a 30% and put the other unit that might be vacant to the 40%.
Is there a difference in the unit?
No, the same units. It's just we have a certain number of units we're committed. As a regulation for receiving the income from tax credits and receiving the tax credit allocation, we're going to commit to renting to affordable people, and we're going to rent to 9 units of 30% and 12 units of 40% and the balance at 60% of the median income. So that will always be there. There's a regulatory agreement that's recorded with the mortgage that says we have to keep those units at those income levels and rent levels for the length of the mortgage we have and for the length of the tax credit compliance period.
Do you happen to know the number of the units for each of the percents?
I think we
have. Yeah, you were right.
It was 9 for 30%.
9 30% units, 6 40% units, and 27.
60%.
And how long does that stay?
45 years.
Forever.
I notice when I look at a kind of like a sheet, it talks about the expenses that you can take off the gross rent. And there's built in a 5% vacancy fee. Is that wouldn't apply if there was not a vacancy?
Correct.
That's just kind of a give you an idea if there was a vacancy.
Yeah, when we run our performance for underwriting for the banks and for MSHDA and everybody else, they have to see a certain vacancy factor, and it's required by their regs. So that's why we provide a vacancy factor there. We find most of our senior properties are fairly well occupied, 97%+ occupied. So that vacancy factor is next to nothing.
And how is that figure determined? Is that figure every year? Is there somebody that looks at that? Do you decide that? Do we decide that?
Oh, yeah, we look at that on a monthly basis and we produce our monthly reports. We say, okay, we've got 42 units here. We've got two vacant. So, we've got a 7.5% vacancy factor for that month. We got one vacant, but then you got a 2% vacancy, whatever the numbers work out to be. So we keep that tracked on a monthly basis, and then in our reports at year end, and it's in our audit at the year end when we have our accounting firm come into our audits.
That's what I was kind of getting at. So the audit is going to determine what we're going to receive in payment of taxes.
Exactly. That's what our other pilots that we have, we wait for the audit to come in. It gives our annual income, and that's how we determine what the numbers are to calculate the pilot pay.
Now, is there a standard, like a cookie cutter way of doing this, or is this designed by every pilot's different, or how does that work?
No, they're almost all the same. It's the actual rents collected, less the utilities that you pay from the common source for, to get the net shelter rents. It's called the cost of the amount of revenue you've collected to, for housing those people times the rate.
So, any of your labor, snow removal?
That's not discounted.
You can't take that off the rent?
No, that's all figured into the operating budget for departments, but it's not in the pilot calculation at all.
I'm just trying to get an idea of what it looks like.
Yep.
Me, why 45 years?
Well, it's a requirement by MSHTA.
Right.
It's a requirement for MSHTA to receive the tax credits.
For 45 years?
Yes. So, we're required to comply with.
Is the mortgage 45 years?
No. So, the mortgage, we haven't determined the mortgage source yet. It'll either be 35 or 40, but it's because the income will be restricted for 45 years based on the rents and the schedule that we just gave.
Okay, well, Danny, I know in this article that was in the Sunday Grand Rapids paper, there were projects that were required to be 25 years and 30 years, and through a little, what they call loophole, they got turned around and now they're not low income anymore. Through a default process and stuff, I get concerned when I see things like that, and I see a trend starting up, and it looks like there's a decided advantage. As I understand, there's $7 million in tax credits in this program, okay, over the first 10-year period of time. And that's what's happening with these other properties, is they're going 10 years and getting the tax credits, and then they're defaulting. Is there anything that protects us for the tax payment in lieu of taxes over that period? Is anything, you know,
so,
and the contracts I saw protect the developer, but I don't see a whole lot of assurances of backup for the city.
Well, the projects that are going through that is called a qualified contract process, where they're basically appealing the tax credits. That was done starting about 7 years ago. MSHTA required that you waive your right to do that to receive tax credits, so we cannot do that with this project. Additionally, the only other way to relieve the income restrictions would be to go through foreclosure, which would nullify the pilot. So there's no way that we could get out of this relieve ourselves of the income restrictions and keep the pilot in place.
Right. So you get into a situation like this where an apartment gets in trouble and they got to go through foreclosure, or the bank gets involved. Everybody loses in that. But then if you lose your tax credits as a portion of that, then all deals are off with the city. And, you know, because the pilot is conditioned on being tax credit eligible.
And I can see us doing this and never ever getting anything near 10% again. Maybe that's a pessimistic point of view. But once you open the door, it's hard to close the door. And I know, Joe, we as a city could always say, no, we're not going to do it, because the city council's option to grant or not grant a pilot, even though we have an ordinance that allows that. I'm just sitting back saying, we'll never see anything above that level again. What developer would offer any more than that? Especially now that 2% have been offered and approved in Grand Rapids and Ludington. If that's the trend, I can see we're going to get trapped in the same ballpark here. So.
Well, you know, from the calculations here, though, you see that you're essentially, it looks like giving the same amount of money, a little bit more, to the city from where you're at right now to where we're proposing to be. And as we increase rents, 2-3%, whatever it is a year, the rents go up, the net rent available for pilot payment goes up. So there is an increasing trend here as rents do go up. It's not a static amount. We hope we're not going to be stuck at the same rental amount forever, because other costs are increasing as well. So we plan on increasing the rental amounts as we go through, and that's factored in our performance as well. So as the rents increase, then the net rent available for a pilot calculation is also increased, and the net pilot increases as well.
I hear a municipal service agreement. Is that something that you, that the developer would be open to?
That's something we've used in the past, whereby the city figures that with a pilot, they wouldn't be able to recoup all the services that are available at the site there. But there again, what we have in our budget is a finite amount that we figured each month for taxes, or each year for taxes in there. So depending on how that's split up. Some municipalities we work with say, you know, we really want the project, but we're concerned about, you know, fire or police protection there, and we don't know if the pilot, as you have it said here, is going to take care of that. So we'll go back and we'll get a lesser pilot amount, but go from a 5% or 4% or 3% down to 2%, and then everybody can split that amount up. And then we'll take some of the money back to the city as a municipal services agreement to pay for the services that we think wouldn't be paid for on the pilot. So
well, when you try to look 45 years out, nobody has a crystal ball, but we know nothing's going down.
Right.
It's pretty hard to carve something in stone for 45 years. Mm-hmm. Mr. Bradford mentioned we have one that it increases every, with inflation, is it? Or how does that increase?
It's based on the some measure of the housing rent inflation. And I check it every year. The federal government captures, it's a component of CPI, or a subset of CPI, and we adjust that $2,500 by that for this project over here for the Manistee Place.
So, you know, that's one of the things I see. Nothing gets any cheaper. And how do you protect her children, because we're looking at their future down the road, and I'm probably not going to be around to see the end result of all this at 75. That brings up another interesting observation or research I did, that the baby boomer age is between 50 and 71. How many of those are going to be around in 45 years? And I think about the flexibility you would have within that apartment if there weren't. The baby boomers are going to be leaving us, me included, at a rapid rate, and pretty soon.
And then we got the Gen X's and Gen Y's. And
well, he might be 55 by then. I don't know, it's the way you think. The population is actually going down in the United States. So, I mean, just all of those things kind of play into all of this, and trying to look 45 years in the future is not an easy thing for me.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I have a couple questions for phase three, because I'm interested in knowing really how seriously you're thinking about condos or something else for that building. So if you could speak to that.
Well, go ahead.
Yeah, sure. We're interested in seeing what the market rate units that are being built now are doing. This would help defray our land costs for building something like that, and I think it's something that we've started planning right now, but we need to understand where the market's at.
I think that's a few years off as well. If everything gets approved on this thing, it's going to probably be a year and a half to 2 years before we open the front door on this place. So we're talking at least 5 years probably on phase three, and things change from year to year. I mean, as Chris said, the market is the biggest driver of that, but it's anticipated that we're going to have, you know, mostly market rate units there rather than tax.
Okay.
Right. So, right. No income restrictions.
Right, no income restrictions, which I'm beginning to think is going to be a space that we need, only because having now checked some of the senior housing developments that are around in the area and finding out how long their waiting lists are to get in.
Right.
Maybe 2 years out on average on some of these. So.
Yeah. All indications are currently that there's a huge demand for affordable senior housing, particularly in this market area, and in most market areas. And you see that on the national news every day. Affordable housing of all types is vastly underserved in most parts of the country. And this being one of them. And then, you know, but over the years, there's only so much that with that market that needs to be served. So I mean, to implement more than one type of housing, mixed rate projects where we have market rate and tax credit is another way that we're building some things now in various parts of the state.
Have you done condo units before, condo projects before?
We've not done condo.
Okay, I'm wondering how that would work, whether it would work like a regular condo where you pay your property taxes directly to the city as an owner.
Right, right. That's
which
a whole
would
different
really be helpful to the city, yeah. Actually, I think.
It would be standard because this pilot would only affect phase two.
Okay, good to know.
You know, when this first started out, it was advertised as a senior housing complex with an affordable component. Now it is strictly low income, very low income, and ultra low income housing. It means a single person with, you know, or even a couple with one income stream that makes more than, I believe the standard right now is $22,140, would not qualify to move into that apartment. Is that correct?
It's an individual.
That would be one individual, but it's very close. Yeah, 26,000 for a couple.
Okay. And if you fill 27 units with people at or below 60% AMI, and I'm assuming it's a county adjusted median income, you didn't have any applicants that were 30 or 40, you could not put them in those apartments. You'd have to hold those for people at 30 and 40 and below levels. Is that correct?
Correct. That's right.
If I'm 68, let's say I make $20,000 a year, had custody of a 9-year-old grandchild, would I be eligible to move in there?
No, sir.
No. Well, being the fact that you have custody of your grandchildren, Michigan law says you got to be. It can't be more than 50 years.
Yeah,
so that would be fine.
I'm just looking at situations. I'm not trying to micromanage our facilities. You know, I'm kind of baffled that it's not affordable to pay taxes and do this unless you make all these concessions. I'm just wondering how it got to be where it is.
Section 42 of the IRS code. Put all this together and refined it a little bit further. So that's the hoops you have to jump through to get the dollars that are out there to do these kinds of things. And so,
you know, I got to think somewhere, somehow, someone's making some money. So, that is investors like to do that.
Yeah. Yields are at an all-time low for the tax credit investors.
So, you know, if you can excuse me for being a little skeptical and asking some questions, I'm looking for the interest of the people that are paying taxes in the city of Manistee for all these services and hoping, you know, to give them some relief. I asked early on about our refuse, you know, and you could roll back that 1.25 mills that we pay for refuse in the city, not without doubling the rates. That people pay, you know, for the monthly trash pickup, and say, well, that's not a good idea. And then that question comes up in here. So okay, so half of our refuse rate is on tax millage, and you're not going to pay tax millage.
But we're going to have our own dumpster that we have to pay for as well. So I mean, there's give and take on both sides.
Not knowing exactly who the people are that are on the waiting list to get into this new apartment complex for the seniors. But we had some breakdown on how many were coming from the city. Now, we don't know if they're homeowners or not. So I guess just to remind everybody that a large portion of these people have probably been taxpayers in the county or within the city. And they need some place that they want to retire. And I have to take care of a lawn, and they're looking for a place like this. So I don't think it's fair to say that we're going to get a whole bunch of them from out of town. I think most of them are going to come from our area, as indicated by this list that we've at least done at least one pass at it to break them down. So I think we have to be careful about the fact that I think this is a way of helping taking care of our senior citizens. That are here, And this is how I'm looking at this housing complex more than anything else.
I believe there was, I think when David spoke with us last week, I think it was between 13 and 16 homes, people with homes that were on the list that that could potentially turn them around and go to an uncapped tax on that particular home. So
The list is people of interest. I don't believe there was any financial qualifications, and I know there are several people that I talked to when they found out it was low income that were way over the income. They thought that it would be some market rate or something they could move into as far as convenience. But as far as I know, you know, whoever applies gets an apartment. It doesn't matter if they're in Detroit or Kalamazoo or where. The city doesn't get a priority, do they?
No, there's no priority. It's fair housing. But in our experience, in markets like this, the vast majority are local residents.
So someone puts their house up for sale, and they want to move into this complex. Does the fact that their house is up for sale, does that mean anything? Does it disqualify them, or
no, not at all. I mean, they could be counted as part of the income. It's the same example that I used. If they have X amount of dollars in a bank account, if the house was worth $50,000, that could be an asset counted as towards their income.
So their capital gains would count, right?
Well, it's just 2% of the value of the assets.
It's just 2%. So okay. The government says we use a 2% imputed interest on that.
And if I read this right, even if they were selling it on a reverse mortgage, or I mean, if they had it on a reverse mortgage, the income didn't count. Did I read that right?
That I'd have to check on, but I think they just take the
reverse mortgage income does not count. The way I read it the other night, I was kind of surprised about that wouldn't count. Okay, so it's considered an exempt asset, in other words, if it's up for sale or if it's just sitting there. If they rent it, then that rental income, probably minus expenses, then it's going to count as income. I imagine there's some deductions from that.
Yeah, right. Offset by mortgage payments and whatever.
Or if it's interest paid for, payments. Then it's going to be their taxes or their expenses.
Taxes, insurance, yeah.
So when you say it's 60% of income, of the 22, so if you get 60% of the 22,000, that's like 13,200.
That is the 60% of it. So it's
22,000 is the 60% of the counted in income.
Yeah.
Okay. Which is, so it's, what, 45 or 47.
And a county median is like $37,000.
Yeah, 37. For two people, it's $42,001.
So. Okay, so you got that.
Okay. Does that change, that median income change on a regular basis and change everything?
Typically.
Over
on an annual basis.
Yes, sir. Annually it changes. HUD puts these numbers on. So. I guess what, you know, one of the biggest things that I see as an advantage here too is the fact that there's going to be $8 million invested in this community. And some people here have alluded to the fact that, you know, we're going to have contractors, we're going to be providing jobs, we're going to have some ongoing full and part-time jobs at the development there. We're going to have people in restaurants and motels and buying parts and pieces for the building locally as much as we can and on an ongoing basis to keep the place running. So it's a lot of money coming in the city, and there's going to be runoffs from that to a lot of the local businesses, and you know, it's $8 million is a big investment in town.
What's the average length of time it takes to put one of these buildings up when you start? Is there an average? Or
about a year.
About a year?
Sometimes less, depending on when we start, you know, if it's winter or spring or depending on when we get the building roughed in and the roof on it.
I from the very beginning and through today, I'm still very supportive of the Council on Aging facility in development and bringing the grocery store. My initial feeling is that I was led to believe, and I specifically asked the question if that was a standalone project from the housing, and was told early on, yes, it was. And asked the question again with the Downtown Development Authority when they gave the resolution of support and was assured that yes, the two projects stood apart. and then we come to find out you can't have one now without the other. I would be the first to recognize that the Council on Aging needs more space. They have outgrown their facility, and they certainly need to move into something that offers them a better option to serve their clients. I'm not very warm to changing the ordinance and the pilot payment. Again, I think we just, I think we head down the wrong road when we do that, and we'll never see the benefits that we had in the past. Once you give it away, it's kind of gone. You can't put it back in the box. So, but you know, I appreciate you coming and answering my questions. I appreciate your honesty, and I'll be honest with you.
The one thing I would say to that is that we, in the last 2 years, we've signed pilots anywhere from 1% to 12%, just depending on what the deal could afford. We did a 12% in Saline, Michigan, where the rents were a little higher, and they could afford to do that. You know, we share cash flow on all of our deals, and we try to fit it to what we can do there to make the project work. So,
40% of the median income rents down there are $800, so it's a higher income area, so it's a huge difference. So we had more income to be able to afford a higher pilot rate. We had two pilots at 4% in Grand Rapids and one in Escanaba currently. So,
a 1% East Lansing.
And a 1% East Lansing. So, it's all over the board depending on the needs of everybody, the development, the community, and the.
Is 1% out to 45 years or longer?
I think that one is 50 years because it was tied with the lease on the building.
So several, maybe 2 years ago, the Planning Commission did a study on or trying to make Manistee a more walkable city. And I think this project will help that, having a grocery store back on the north side again, having new development for seniors for walkability downtown to the brewery, proposed brewery that's coming. We want to make it more family-oriented for the city. I think this project hits those bases.
For me, I agree with that. I agree with what he said. My concern, my issues are making sure that the future generation, and in 45 years I'm talking about the future generation, is protected as much as I can possibly protect them, you know, through inflation or through whatever. So that's what I'm looking at is, what am I setting up for the future generation? How is it going to affect them? I would not want to leave them with a heavy burden. I would want something that was going to be sustainable and useful to them. And I assume the building will last longer than 45 years, right?
I hope so.
And the taxes over that period of 45 years will continue to rise, correct?
Correct. Yeah, as I say, as the rents increase, so does the pilot payment.
And we'll start sewer.
Mm-hmm. Water and sewer rates, we pay the same rate as anybody else. So. And we're starting in about the same position according to these calculations, and we'll just be moving up from there as the rents increase. So.
My position is this: we can't ignore the fact that we have an aging population in this area. We can't ignore the fact that we're short on housing. We also have to apply some knowledge in what a big vacant building, how long it'll sit there vacant. The Glick's building downtown, I've been trying to sell that since 2009. That's a big space. I know it seems crazy. It's supposed to be prime real estate. And again, they've been unsuccessful in selling it. I can only think that having an empty Olson's building out there for 7 or 8 years is going to look pretty unattractive on 31. I think this would be stimulating to our economy here to have a development, especially one that fits so neatly the needs of our area and addresses the Council on Aging needs to become a more vibrant center. They can do so much more with 20,000 square feet than with 4,000 square feet. think it's just going to be a great footprint for us to have on 31. So when I think of the risks on letting it sit there for 7 or 8 years and not finding a buyer and knowing that there just aren't developers who are going to come in here and not take any incentives and just build an $8 million building to help house low to moderate income people, it's not likely. I mean, their operating income is going to be slim to none to come in and do that all on their own. So I can't see why we wouldn't want this and try to work with you to get this to come. So that's my position.
And I believe this does fit into our master plan too. So it hits the points that I think we all really need to look at. So
I would be interested in seeing. I know Horizon's not in the city, but it's a senior residence, right?
Yes, it is. I was there today.
And how many? If they're full, if there's a waiting list.
There's a waiting list.
Okay. And
it's pretty deep. So.
Do you know if it's
okay. Can you clear that? It's not a waiting list. It's a list of interest.
We have a list of interested people for the Olson's project, but I thought she was referring to Verizon.
She is. Well,
yeah.
She is referring to.
There's a lot of 2-year waiting lists. This is the last time. Mm-hmm.
2-year wait?
That was the last I heard of Horizon.
And is that building the income restriction too on that?
They're pretty close. They're a little higher there. I checked into that today.
Because I know that's pretty,
it's around 24,000 for a single and 27,000 for 20 for a couple. But then their units are all the same. Their units are all the same, whether all the one bedrooms are the same, all the two bedrooms are the same. And what's kind of interesting about them is that, you know, it's based on their income, so they have to have some that are lower rent, but that one bedroom is the same as any other one bedrooms down there. And if you're over the 27,420, from what you told me on the phone, and again, you're free to double check or do whatever you want, but you can still get in there, but you're gonna pay the highest rent there, the highest market rent that they have, and what you quoted me was fairly reasonable. So, I mean, it's still reasonable for this area, in fact, so.
But that's still got a waiting list.
Yes, it does, which means we need more. So, yeah, and they tend to be happy there, and they don't turn over very often. Now, Reese Park and Cherry Hill are also managed by the same people that manage Horizon Point.
Senior.
And their qualifications seem to be a little bit different in that if your income level does go above the highest one, then you, it's my understanding, especially in Reese Park, that you have to go someplace else. So, and again, I've just had a couple of conversations. One was with the rental person there at Horizon Point today, and I was there visiting people and touring the building at Horizon Point. So it's a really nice building. The seniors all seem very happy there. So I was amazed at how clean it was. So it's a good project.
What is MISTA's requirement for a yearage? They said up to 50 years, correct?
The state statute allows pilots up to 50 years. I believe on this particular project before you, they're looking at a 45-year term. But by statute, a community could go up to 50.
Who said that? MISTA set the 45 years?
The state set the statute of up to 50 years.
Correct.
And apparently there's a program they can take advantage of with MISTA that is a 45-year commitment.
But is there a program for, say, 40 years?
I don't know. I don't know.
I might be able to shed some light. We have a pilot program run with the tax credit compliance period, which is 45 years. If that helps. The compliance period is a total of 45 years. We have to keep these things affordable for that whole time. So we want the ordinance to follow compliance period. It doesn't have to go to the 50, so we're only at 45.
So if we granted 45, the MSHDA financing one would meet that, right?
Right.
45.
Exactly.
Okay.
It'd be, yeah, in line with that. Yeah.
All right.
Have you heard some of these same questions from other other townships?
Yes. Yeah.
Other cities? Or?
Everybody's concerned, and you know we're trying to make the numbers work, and we've been forthright and honest with everybody, showing the same numbers, you know, that we've shown you folks, and that's baked into the deal. Our banks seen that, our investors seen that, MSHDA's seen that. Everybody's looking at St. Orr's, and other communities have asked the same questions and scrutinized our numbers as well, and make sure that you know we're providing the same information to everybody.
I also understand your success rate in receiving that approval is pretty high.
We've been very, very lucky. We typically pick developments that we think are going to succeed in not only getting the financing but getting the tax credits as well. And we've had very good luck over the last several years.
And can you enlighten me just a little bit on the tax credit? How do you get it all in one lump sum? Does it come over a period of time? It
comes over a period of 10 years. So our investors buy the tax credits from us, and they get 1/10 of that total amount for 10 years. So they can take the tax credit and put it towards their income tax return, 1/10 at a time over 10 years.
Is there any way this project can happen that's more than 4%, like 6%? Or does it have to be 4%? There's no other way.
That's how we baked the numbers in. Once we add it all together, the total expense of the project, soft costs, hard costs, operating expenses, and mortgage payments, we came up with that number that we have that we can pay for taxes, and that's how we backed into the number of 4%.
So, like, if it was
5%,
there's no way?
There's only one thing that could change on that is, more deferred fees that go out there, but if those deferred fees can't get paid, then MSHDA's not going to look on the project as feasible.
Deferred fees, explain that.
Well, deferred fee, we get paid a developer fee for doing this project, and we've deferred a substantial portion of that, so we can only collect that out of cash flow over a certain period of time. But it has to be paid within 15 years. So if that developer fee is not able to be paid out of cash flow that's available from operations of the project over 15 years, MSHDA sees it as an unfeasible project and would not grant us tax credits on it. It gets involved because it would be, if we don't take the whole developer fee over and get it paid out in the 15 years, then there's a recapture of all the tax credits and everything else, and it's a big mess, and we have to pay it back, all the $7 million back to MSHDA and everything else. So MSHDA's not going to let that happen. Our investors aren't going to let that happen, and the banks aren't going to let that happen. So we have to come up with a very hardcore performer that we can hang our hat on, and that's where we came up with these numbers.
Right now, what I'm reading from the situation in Grand Rapids, the developer has got 7 properties that he's done this little loophole thing on. They're not having to pay back their tax credits. They get beyond a point where they have to reimburse MSHDA for the tax credits, and they're able to get out of their affordable housing clause with a 3-year window on that.
Yeah, that's completely.
I think the legislation that will probably fix that little loophole,
most
that from happening in the future. So.
But if they get out of their tax credit compliance regulations, and the city gets out of the pilot regulations as well, so then they'd be paying full ad valorem taxes.
That has been closed on future deals.
Any further questions?
So I guess this work session was called about the pilot ordinance. What do we want to do? Do we want to keep it at the 10-year or at the 10% 35-year, or do we want to go with a recommendation from the city manager of having negotiable up to the 45-year?
I think you want it up to 50.
Well, a couple of things. In a work session, you can't make a decision.
Right.
Number two, the council did table that agenda item from, I think it was the last meeting in February, until after this work session. So that topic will be on your March 20th agenda as an action item. Okay. So it'll be taken off the table for your action. So you'll have an opportunity next Monday to address that.
I want to remind everybody that the next council meeting is on Monday, because Capitol Conference is Tuesday and Wednesday down at Grand Central.
Well, the thing was, it was the wording in the agenda. So.
Yeah, it was on the agenda before with some wording in there and a recommendation to change up to 10% and to extend it to 50 years. So that will be back on the agenda in the same format.
Now, a question for Mr. Bradford. DDA service fees to the city. I mean, and I don't know how to ask this question, so I'll just ask it. What the heck? The DDA will be getting funding from this project or taxes. So would that give us more leverage to ask for more fees?
The DDA is going to be taking a slight hit. About $1,500 a year. So I don't think this will impact negatively our housing.
However, the DDA with the Stillwater project here on the old hotel site is going to capture all the taxes on that property as they start building the condos in it, because there's no concessions on it at all.
Something we remember. Okay.
Mr. Bradford, if this is I don't know how to ask this. I guess we talked about there'd be little or no service charge, or we wouldn't have to pay a lot to keep this building going, or there wouldn't be a lot of things we'd have to do or expenses. If there were, could you identify any expenses we might incur with a building like this that you think of? You know what I mean?
We've talked about it in staff meetings. There's going to be nothing that the DPW is going to be doing. So that takes out a cost center. Fire, it's a brand new building, fully suppressed. I don't see any fire runs there. In terms of the police, there may be some, but Chief Bachman thought it would be minimal at best. And then in terms of EMS, given the demographics, the population there, one would expect we may have more EMS calls there. However, if it does necessitate a transport, that's a new revenue stream for us. So we, in essence, when we talked about it in staff, we didn't think the service demands were going to be exceptional by any means. They're going to be minimal.
So is there still an argument that we could get, maybe work with them and get an assessment, or get a services
there agreement? There is, and it's my understanding, you know, they have a finite amount of dollars. It's how you split it up. And like Ludington did, they apparently took a lower pilot, but then they had a municipal services agreement. It's my understanding that whatever you have in the municipal service agreement goes to the city and no one else. So as an example, if they're set on the 4% and the city wanted to split it and say a 2% pilot, then that 2% pilot, whatever that number is, gets split, much like it is up here, amongst other taxing jurisdictions, DDA. But the municipal services agreement, all of those dollars would go directly to the city in recognition of some increased level of service provision.
Then isn't that an advantage to our taxpayer?
It's an advantage to the city, yes.
Any
further discussion?
I just don't.
If we're going to do, it'd be on the agenda.
But the discussion is on the ordinance, the pilot ordinance.
Yes.
We can't discuss that because it's on the agenda for next week, so why isn't it on there?
Because we wanted to go through a thorough discussion of what this is all about and what it encompasses and stuff. What happened was the pilot proposed change to the pilot to change it from 10% to up to 10% and extend it to 45 years was on the last council agenda. It was tabled until we had an opportunity to further discuss it and hash it out in a work session. Now we'll be back on
the next council agenda. Perhaps this might help. There's going to be two things. The first is the next agenda, the council will be bringing off the table that recommendation that I presented to modify the ordinance to allow up to 10%, up to 50 years. So, you know, you got that latitude. If that is approved by council, then it would go through an ordinance amendment process, and we would do that. So if council agrees to amend the ordinance per the recommendation, then the following meeting, I would fully expect that Third Coast Development would be making a request of council for the pilot they want, the 4%, 45 years. So the action on upcoming Monday, next meeting, is the council going to want to amend the ordinance? If it does, if there is positive action on that, then we work with the city attorney to amend the ordinance, have our two readings, and then after that, I think it's 10 days, it goes into effect. And if that amendment is approved, then that provides an opportunity for Third Coast Development to come before council and make that specific request for the pilot that they want to make this deal work.
Is that the time we would talk about municipal services to also?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. And it has nothing to do with any existing pilot agreements that are out there?
No.
So we're talking about this development because this is what brought up the change.
Yes.
Basically.
And if I might add, if council chooses to amend the ordinance, it also doesn't have a direct impact on any future pilots, although the mayor correctly points out that, you know, if we did do a lower pilot for this one, a future developer might ask for that, but it doesn't bind council.
We could amend the ordinance and approve a pilot under the amended ordinance at anything up to 10% and up to 50 years. And another developer could come in and say, well, gee, I'd like a pilot at 3% or 2% also. And you say, you know, no thanks, we just did one. You know, we're not obligated because we have an ordinance. The ordinance gives us the right to extend a pilot to a developer, but we're not obligated to do so. So you want to make sure people understand that. Just because we do one doesn't mean we have to do another. We always have the right to say no.
So each development or each project will stand by on its own. You would determine the good, the bad, the indifferences.
You took the words out of my mouth. You'd have to look at each one individually, much like they did, lay out the numbers, have them verify.
How does it affect the community?
Exactly. Yeah, you
got it.
Do we have to stay with that language, though? Can we say no less than 4%?
You can do whatever you would like.
Instead of no higher than 10%?
Right now, I was trying to mirror the state
right.
statute. That to me was the easiest fix. You can approve something up to 10% and up to 50%. Doesn't mean you have to. So really what it's saying, you can go from 0 to 10% and from 0 years to 50 and anything in between.
Right, like, but what, for an example that they use, they had one that had 12% pilot. Well, if we wouldn't even be able to get that if we kept the verbiage of no more than 10%.
Well, that's not exactly true. It might not be a 12% pilot, but if they could afford 12%, we could say we want to 10% pilot and 2% municipal services would come out to the same amount of money.
We would
anything in between.
But how many would come up and say, oh yeah, we can afford more than that?
Well, then that's the responsibility of staff working with council, and we've developed a worksheet that people are going to be bringing to his developers, that not only just pilots, but other, any other tax programs that they want to take advantage of, like an NZ or Oprah, and then they got to lay out all this information for us to evaluate and then provide that to council so they can see what they're looking for, what's their revenues, what they can afford, get all that information together. So you'll be able to absolutely make the right decision.
This ordinance gives us flexibility.
In reality, we could make a recommendation next week to change the ordinance to authorize pilots up to the amount of ad valorem taxes, and that would include everything in range from zero up to what the actual taxes would be.
I don't know that that's allowed by state statute. I think I'm correct in saying it's 10% ceiling on it, but
there are rules. I'm sorry, Mr. Taylor.
We have to defer to the city attorney to provide that input, but that was my understanding, was 10% within the state statute.
The Mr. Rules, do they look after both the developer and the investor like us? I mean, are they geared so when this is done, it's looking after both parties, or is it tilted one way or the other, or don't you know?
I would think that they're probably looking out for NISHTA.
Okay.
That's fair. That would be my guess.
That's a safe answer.
Yeah.
I would think that they're working for both. I mean, they're trying to find a way to solve the housing problem shortages that we have and stimulate some growth for the lower income housing that is necessary to take care of different portions of our population.
Yeah, sure.
So it's a two-way street. They're helping the developer and they're also helping society.
Well, when they help themselves, they're pushing their programs to get affordable housing out in the community. That's the point I was making, is that they're protecting their programs, and they want these products out in communities. So they're working with developers and communities both in the interest of Michigan.
Any other comments on this?
Just thank you for your patience.
Now, when we go to our next meeting, when we talk about this or approve it or whatever, we can still change the verbiage.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So we don't have to like say it here. Just have it put on the agenda as an option.
Yeah, it's already going to be on the agenda because the council had tabled action.
Right. I know that we tabled the language on the poll, but that proposal can change.
Yes.
Mayor, before we go to the next meeting, may we have a 5-minute recess?
I would say let's take a 5-minute break, but please keep it short. Yeah. Before we go to the next subject. Let's get going here. Thank everybody for a very spirited discussion and lots of participation on that last item. That we set the stage for us to be much better prepared on Monday. Next item for discussion on the Housing Commission Central Terrace Heart Review, requested by City Council. Councilmember Beaton, you asked for this.
Yes, I did. And I see Clinton is here, which is great. Wait, right in the back there.
Wake him up.
I'm just more confused about the information that we've gotten since October 4th, when you came here in front of council for your review and explained to us in pretty direct terms that the ACC and the resolution and the certified minutes all matched so that it was claim that every unit in the city was for general population. And that has now changed, so I'm trying to put the pieces together. And I'm hoping you can help, of course.
I have a four-page explanation. Would you like me to read it to you?
Go ahead.
You're not even under a time limit, so.
Feel free, man.
Okay, the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development has changed the unit designations of Century Terrace and Harborview from general population back to senior and disabled. The change in the designation has returned 167 units of public housing to senior and disabled housing market, 119 at Century Terrace and 48 at Harborview.
I'm sorry, can we interrupt when we have a question, because we might forget, you know, some of us are seniors. So
I have printed copies for you.
Oh, so, okay. I'm just curious, when they changed the designation, or did you notify them that you thought it needed to be changed? That's the part I'm confused.
I'm going to get to that.
Okay,
you need
good.
To understand the history. But also I want to emphasize that your public housing authority is absolutely different than what you were just discussing.
And I know that's okay. That's an important factor for everybody too.
Absolutely different. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure where they get their statistics for their information on area median income. It's not the same as what's published by HUD, and that's what we're required to follow. I was working on that at dinner time, 51,500, I think it is for our city.
Would you rather have us hold questions until after you're done?
You can go ahead and interrupt, about, you know, if I'm going to get to that question, which your question I'll be getting to.
I'm very satisfied with your answer. Thank you.
Okay. A couple important definitions. In general population, public housing units that are to be rented to eligible program participants that are 18 years of age or older, or emancipated youth. Senior and disabled housing unit designation. Public housing units that will be rented to eligible program participants that are either 55 or older or disabled. A big difference now between the project and your public housing. And disabled, an individual who has been declared disabled by the state or the Social Security Administration. There is no age category. So the designation now is senior and disabled. 55 and plus, and disabled. Okay. I'll be dealing with this more on Monday than that. Our income is different. Okay. Our income qualifications is, you're homeless, you have no money, I got to house you. Okay. There's a complete difference. Background history. And you really need to hear this entire background to understand how the changes came about. March 1, 2005, I was appointed Executive Director of the Housing Commission. I reviewed the current policies, procedures, and operations and revealed that multiple policies required by HUD were out of date, not in compliance with current regulations, and many of the existing policies were not being followed in day-to-day operations. Key to this is that we're a federal agency within your midst. Compliance is not an option. Operational procedures not followed or applied consistently on a day-to-day operational basis. We had multiple vacant units left by the previous administration for an extended period of time, up to 5 years, that maintenance had turned into storage, and that the previous administration was collecting and embezzling operational funds on and capital funds on. Balance of 2005. Recent embezzlement by the former executive director placed us on a high list of oversight and heightened awareness by the Detroit Field Office. Increasing the occupancy rate of the CMHC units, remember we had several that were vacant up to 5 years, was of high importance for HUD. HUD was also in the transition of closing this gap where this could happen and going from paper reports to an online inventory system. Okay, that online inventory system was in place when I arrived. They were aware then of how many units we have, They know right now how many units we have, what unit is in what building, who is in that building, in that unit, what their income is, their age, their name, their social security number, where their income sources come from. All that is known on the individual within a particular unit. All by the electronic systems that were created. The field office provided guidance and support because of this heightened awareness of watching over us. And so I contacted the field office for some of their support on how to deal with these vacant units that we had that were over 12 months. And I spoke with the director of the field office, and Mr. Robert Nelson at the time, about marketing to the elderly and the disabled, which we were operationally following as our designation and understanding as our designation. At the conclusion of that phone call, I was informed that we were not senior and disabled. We were general population. They cited the field office. Failure of the previous executive director to maintain required paperwork to keep the designation as senior and disabled. Now, such a determination, when granted, was only good for a 5-year period, and once lost, was not usually granted again.
Oh, that was back in the 70s, right?
It was built, Century Terrace, in 68 and 72 at Harborview. Okay. So they're saying the 5-year periods were separate time frames.
Okay.
And then the verification of the online system that's maintained by HUD. The field office also informed us that if we didn't provide the housing to the general population, it would jeopardize our funding. We're 100% federally funded. It would be a violation of the annual contributions contract. Thus, they would take receivership. And it would be a violation of the Fair Housing Act as discrimination against family and age. The information was shared with the Board of Commissioners, which determined that, having been properly informed by HUD of the need to change operational procedures, and having reviewed the HUD inventory system, and having received funding based on the designation of general population and being alerted that we were being monitored, our best operational procedure was to follow the HUD directive. Not happily. In June 2009, we began our several attempts to change the designation. We thought we'd start with the Harborview property. We submitted a formal application to change the unit designation back to senior and disabled. We chose Harborview over Century Terrace for the following reason. Century Terrace has 119 units, many of which were already occupied at that point by program participants qualifying as general population. Harborview experienced a very low turnover in the interim years from 2005 to 2009. And the applications that we were receiving, the timing was such that as a vacancy occurred at Harborview, we didn't have an available rentable unit at Century Terrace, and we just so happened to have an applicant who fit senior disabled, even though it was general population. So we maintained a higher rate of senior and disabled at Harborview. HUD's response to our formal written request. First, Fair Housing informed us that they would deny the application because we could not provide statistical information spanning a 20-year period indicating that qualifying applicants from the general population would not be prohibited from receiving access to low-income housing because of the senior and disabled designation. I couldn't find any source to help me with a 20-year period to prove into the future. Second was a technicality. The annual and 5-year plans were required to submit to HUD did not state that we were desirous to change unit designations in any of our properties. We withdrew our application. We did immediately update our annual and 5-year plan and have had it state desire to bring units into senior and disabled housing ever since the 2010 annual five-year plan. So we had that option. Because he, at Manistee Council meeting on August 20th, 1968, submitted to HUD by City Clerk Margaret Fett, establishes any of the properties as elderly, senior, or disabled. The information that I cited in my 2016 report is information cited by HUD to us as part of the ongoing attempts to change the designation of Century Terrace and Harborview. A cursory review of the ACC documents in the possession of the CMHC affirmed HUD's position and no further investigation of documents were pursued. Why did we not pursue the investigation of the ACC documents? One, the field office regularly reviews the on-site documents during their on-site reviews, the most recent of which was September 2016. Each review affirmed the inventory designation status as correct due to the previous administration's failure to update the senior and disabled status after the expiration of the initial designation period. The field office is the first step in seeking approval of unit designation change. And since the field office site had repeatedly declared everything was correct for the current designation in the inventory system, there appeared to be no option for us. The only indication provided by the field office, other than the HUD review teams was looking at things, was that we needed to update from the old form of the ACC to the new form of the ACC due to changes in federal procurement regulations. So, beginning in January, top of my list was the updating of the ACC from the old form to the new form. The first thing that required was a thorough investigation of all the documents in our possession that relate to the ACC so that I clearly know what is there so I can put it into the format of the new document. In that reading, I discovered a subnote. And in that subnote, it pulled out those units at Century Terrace, the two ACCs, one for Century Terrace and one for Harborview. The subnote pulled out that those units were senior disabled while we built family units that were general population, built Harborview. Those units pulled out senior disabled while we built additional family units, general population. So I sent an email to my superiors in Detroit. So I'm reading this and it's opposed to what you're saying. And I've said all these years. And I can't find any documentation of us receiving information that we had to fill out a renewal or anything in the documentation that you stated, HUD, that we needed to redo on this. They requested, since I had raised, sealed, blue ink copies, that we scan those in and mail them to them. Email them to him. I received a phone call back in 15 minutes. That's a record time for HUD. And they were, are you reading this correctly? What are you reading? And they said, give us a few minutes. 10 minutes later, they called back. We went into the archives. We found our copies of your copies, originals. We're looking for the other documents that state that you lost it. I said, I can't find anything in my records. So we have to refer it to legal, HUD Legal. HUD Legal reviewed it. By the end of January, I was informed that we were correct and they were wrong. I asked, what happened? Why, after all these years, did you not believe what we were saying, what the city was saying on this? And their response was that someone in the now defunct and closed Grand Rapids field office made a mistake, and Director Nelson didn't investigate that mistake. And they were all entering the numbers in the PIC, and we went with what was entered into PIC by the Grand Rapids office as the correct legal documents. HUD Legal has determined that there are no other documents that override the documents that we have. So there's only one obstacle left, a letter which you all received a copy of, that Dale and I sent to the field office requiring the formal change. I received an email at about 4:30 this afternoon from HUD, and all 119 units and all 448 units at Harborview are now officially changed in the HUD inventory system back to senior and disabled. We've been operating and filling them on a legal basis, but now the inventory system reflects it. I got as close to an answer as we're going to get. Someone made a mistake in the field office, and that's the way it is, and we fixed it. How are we going to deal with this right now? What's our transition plan? The current occupancy at Century Terrace is 73% that are seniors and disabled. Remember the definitions of senior and disabled. 87% are at Harborview. That's 87% filled. Grade metal. That's in there. Eventually, I'd like to get that out of there. But, you know, and money-wise, it's going to have to wait. You know, with that. Hopefully that satisfies your understanding of how things got to be this way. There was no trickery involved in the Housing Authority side. We've been trying for years. We've had on-site visits multiple times by HUD. We've had varying levels of people from HUD in here, from field office directors to regional directors reviewing us. So they've all pushed and insisted that they were right and we were wrong. So, can I answer any questions?
Well, I, for one, would like to see a letter from Detroit with one of those nice seals on it that's notarized that you could frame so that it won't get lost or anything.
We have better than that. I have the original documents that are raised sealed. They're in our fireproof room and fireproof safe.
What I'm saying is I want Detroit to really acknowledge that this is the correct designation.
Brown that baby and put it on the wall.
We won't get an acknowledgement from Detroit.
We won't. All we'll get is the email. That's it.
That we were required to make the formal request, and now I have the formal request approved and all my units turned over. I would give you a printout of my PIC. I'll double check and see if we can do a PIC run without it listing occupiers of the unit, because that would be a violation of the Privacy Act. If I can do that, I'll bring in the units. They're listed in the inventory system to show it, but that's the closest we'll get.
You're going to be presenting on the 20th to council on a report anyway, aren't you?
Yes.
Okay.
I really don't, like you said, they're going to be different from the senior housing that's been proposed for the Olson property.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, why don't we look at those, why don't we talk about those differences again, just so that I'm clear on maybe.
I'll have more available details when I come on Monday, because okay. I'm working on the numbers. But I can give you some basics right now.
Okay.
We have 214 rentable units. We pay $38,000 to the water every year. So it's interesting the estimations that were made on that. You know, in Harborview and Century Terrace have the same size units that are being estimated for the new project. We have to take people down to zero income. Our average rental rate across our property, so I was working on all of our properties before I came here, is $244. That's our average across all of them, from a one bedroom to a four bedroom. My minimum rent is zero. minimum rent technically is 50. You can be paid to live in public housing. Our utility allowance requires that if you have $100 rent, because your rent is not calculated on, but you here's your income bracket and this is the rent. Ours is we have to run it through a formula developed by Congress and HUD. You plug the numbers in, it kicks it back at 30% of their adjusted gross income. And there's a lot of deducts that go into that. So except that 30% minus utilities. People living at Harborview receive an electric utility. People at Century Terrace receive a utility allowance. People at Century Terrace receive no utility allowance because we pay all utilities. Family sites, they vary on electric and gas. We pay all the water, and we have a limit set by HUD on the water. HUD does not pay for air conditioning. I have to bill back air conditioning. That's a congressional determination. You don't. Air conditioning is luxury. Ours, our Congress people are concerned. They don't pay for more than one refrigerator, one stove, you know, one microwave, one TV, one stereo. Other than that, you go above that, I gotta charge you based on what our energy performance contractor determined, because this is taxpayer dollars that fund this, and so you're allowed this limit. Go above that, I have to charge you for that. So there's some differences in how we go back and forth, but we do have, I think we're down to across the properties, two or three people who are in zero income, and which means that zero rent having to pay, and then an additional two or three that they're not paying rent because their rent has been reduced by the level of the utility allowance. So the $100 utility allowance in your unit, the $100 rent in your utility allowance is 75, your rent is 50, or 25. If your utility allowance is 125 and your rent is 100, we pay you 25. We don't pay directly to the program participant. The CFR thankfully allows us to set up our ACOP policy such that we pay directly to utility companies. And the tenant has to bring us a utility bill. We don't pay their late fees because they forgot to bring it in. We evict them if they get disconnected, even though we're supposed to pay the utility bill. If they didn't bring it into us, we can't pay the bill, and they got to pay the late fee and the reconnect fee and all those kind of things.
Are
like
you
that.
Having that problem with the seniors and the elderly disabled as well as the general population?
Well, there's always outliers, and we've had a couple of seniors in that category. Okay. Sometimes that's due to just forgetfulness. Sometimes, a lot of times, it's due to most of our seniors are out of money by the 15th. I mean, out of money, totally, by the 15th. So most of it happens in our family homes because that's where the families are, and that tends to be where we have it. The heaviest utility allowance is applied is in the family homes. So you could have a family of four living in one of our four-bedroom, family living in one of our four-bedroom units, paying $50 a month, in a house with $125 a month utility allowance.
Clinton, what sort of a payment in lieu of taxes does the Housing Commission make to the city?
10% of adjusted gross, which is 10% of our income, our rental income, minus utilities that are paid. So ours is about $38,000. I had it in one report I produced for you guys, $38,000 something, almost $39,000 projected for 2000.
Do you make any services fee payment beyond that? Or just
our payment in lieu of taxes is outside of your ordinance. It's created by the ACC. It's created by the Code of Federal Regulations. The 10% is inclusive You can't adjust down, you can't adjust up, you can't add to, you can't subtract to. But that's beyond anyone's hands because it was established in 1937 with the Housing Act. One interesting thing I came across today is that the Housing Authority, the residents put in $2.3 million income into the city of Manistee a year. That's the cash they receive and operate from. So they go to the store, they go out to eat. Medicaid pays for their medications, their doctor's visits and stuff. So we have a huge economic impact just from the residents. And we're compiling figures together of our own footprint of purchases made locally. I have to go by the lowest bid price on things, but we try to buy as much as we can locally. And I might have that stuff.
That 2.3 million is over what time period?
That's just 2016. In 2016, $2.3 million was the income of the residents on the Manistee Housing Authority. And that money then they spent in Manistee. So it's fairly significant. Here it is.
It's good information for us to know about all the other developments too. I mean, they're generating this, so.
We put in the Housing Commission spent $170,667.29 in local vendors in 2016. So,
how many people do you employ?
Seven, including myself. We have one out for advertisement, so it'll be eight then. But right now, currently seven.
Questions or comments?
No, I think it's a good thing that if they're going back to senior, elderly, disabled in those two units because it's been a huge problem that I've heard about. I had one good friend whose mother lived there and that ended very tragically. For the families that have relatives over there that are in the 73% of the 87%, they're probably pretty excited about the fact that that's going to change.
And of course, hopefully we'll be saving some cent dollars because there's pretty much a undercover officer hanging out in Century Terrace.
Right, and for the displaced families, there's some good people in that mix too, I'm sure, and hopefully you'll find the right
location. Yeah, we will move everyone. No one's going to lose their housing in the process. So they won't lose their housing because of this. If they fail other program requirements, they could.
Do you have a question, Jack?
Well, I think a clarification on pilots. I think there's two different types of pilots. Yours is different than the Mishnah. Because I think I'm correct in that the Mishnah pilot is based on a shelter minus the utilities, but they don't get that. They have whatever they collect in rent, that's what they have to operate that building. They have no other subsidies. I think I'm correct in saying that your facilities don't operate just on the rent you collect.
That's correct. We collect about $600,000 in rent,
right,
and about $400,000 in operational subsidy
from
the Fed. However, you need to consider that's over $1 million comes in that are federalized dollars. The moment the money comes into us, it's instantly federalized. So it all belongs to the Fed. So the Feds will say that we pay according to what Congress said, which is the collected rents, but that's all our money.
The only point I was making is that I think it's different in my mind because the project that Olson's was talking about, whatever they collect in rent, that's what they have to operate their facility on, including the pilot operations. And you get more than just your rents to operate your facility.
Well, currently, the president's budget has $6 billion coming out of HUD, $3 billion coming out of the CDBG funds, $3 billion from other areas, and I recently, as of this morning, read that 30 to 50% of that other $3 billion will come out of funding support for public housing.
But could you operate those two facilities annually just on the rent you collect?
No.
Okay, and pay the pot. Okay, that's the difference. That's the only thing I want to point out. It was different.
Well, you know, the Olson's project's no different. They're getting $7 million in tax credits to subsidize them for the first 10 years of operation.
And that tax, that's
$630,000 a year.
Yeah.
I mean, it didn't disappear. Right. I mean,
I'm just saying it's different. I just want to point that out.
Well, but also, where the tax credit funds come from MSHDA, are balance of state funds from HUD. So ultimately, you can say they're getting high funds too.
Who owns the Manistee Housing Commission? I mean, I know
that's a real
entity.
Yeah.
Which?
Let me ask this first way. Okay. Anybody here United Methodist? And the reason I'm asking is because their policy structure is very similar to the Fed structure. Okay. We sign every year, that agreement renewal, okay? The initial period of the ACC was for 30 years. At the end of 30 years, they gave up ownership if we didn't take any capital funding from them and if we didn't take any operational funding. We can't exist without that. Funds to be able to operate. So every year they extend the ACC agreement, which means as long as there's an active ACC agreement, they hold, under the declarations of trust, first place of ownership. Okay? Second place of ownership then would be the city of Manistee. Okay? But that would be, you know, having to buy out there. You want to add $500,000 to your budget for us? That's just operating.
You're a city function rather than a county function. Is that correct?
We're a local unit of government ourselves. Okay, we're not a department of the city. Most housing commissions began that way in Michigan. And HUD had them remove themselves from that. It's a protection for the city and a protection for HUD. It was a conflict of interest in HUD's mind that the city had it as a department when the city was second place of ownership kind of thing. So they moved that out like that. But so we're our own local unit of government. However, the people that serve on that local unit of government are appointed by
city council.
By the mayor, yes. And that's like the connection, the main connection there. Now, when HUD gets upset about things, they get upset with the housing authority and the city. And they drag you in just as equally with us, like we had a few years ago. Was anybody around on that council at that time?
Jay?
No. This was a few years ago. Mayor Kenny was part. She got dragged into multiple meetings, and so did.
I wasn't wrong, but I was at the meetings, and they were quite interesting, to say the least.
Yes, the antics of HUD was very interesting, weren't they?
Yes, they were.
They have the power. What's called receivership. All of the monies that we own in the bank are under a receivership directive, anyways. So at any time, you know. My in-house accountant can open up a bank account and it could be empty. They own the money. So it's strange. It's hard to explain how it goes back and forth on who they want to put the responsibility and blame onto. So, a prime example is you know, there's like $8 to $10 billion worth of infrastructure work that needs to be done nationally in properties that are owned by the federal government that are called public housing. They don't invest that money into the properties that they own to take care of the infrastructure, you know. So.
Okay, anyone else got any comments or questions? Thank you very much. We look forward to
Monday. Yeah, let me give you this, because this won't be included with the thing on Monday. It'll be a different board. I hope to have that completed so I can email it out to you on Friday. If you have a chance to hear it. But here there won't be as many words. There's more graphs.
Thank you.
I'd like to thank everybody for their attendance here tonight. Thank you to the public here. Thank you to all the council for a very thorough discussion. Most appreciated. Does anyone have a comment they'd like to make before we adjourn?
Nope.